Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today we are beginning a series with the power of a praying church. The power of a praying church. As we think about the church, we think about the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, that even before the church was well established, the Lord gave us an indication that that church will be mighty, that church will be powerful, that church will be solid and strong and steadfast, and that the very gates of hell will not be able to prevail against that church. That tells you then there will be power in that church. There will be authority in that church. In fact, connected with that promise of the Lord is that He'll give us the keys of the kingdom, and that we'll be able to use the keys of the kingdom in the church, which is still telling us about the authority and the power that the church will possess. But the question is, if the church is to possess power, by what means will the church possess power? And one of the means by which the church will possess power is the privilege of prayer. That's why those two things come together, the power and the praying. The praying and the power. The power of a praying church. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, "And I say unto thee, that thou art Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." The very foundation of the church, and the very head of the church, and all the things surrounding the church, they indicate power, the rock, stable power, steadfast power, unmovable power, a kind of power that is irresistible. And it is from that rock, the symbol of power, stability that is, authority that is, and heaven's power here on earth, upon that rock, immovable rock, I will build my church. The I there is Christ, and is the one through Him, the power, is the power that created the whole universe. In fact, we are told in Hebrews chapter 1, it is by Christ that this world is held together. And that passage mentions power again, which means then the foundation of the church, the rock, signifies power. And then the one that is building the church, the chief instrument in the building of the church, power. And then it tells us, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Then in verse 19, "And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom." Again, he's talking about authority here, and he's talking about power. He's talking about the believers who are the co-laborers with the Lord Jesus Christ, and who are the servants of the Lord, who are working with the Lord. He says, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt find on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt lose on the earth shall be loosed in heaven." The church actually recognized that, and therefore the church began to understand that this church, the early church, was going to be built on the very foundation of power, and the key of authority and the key of power had been given unto them. That's why when you open the Acts of the Apostles, you begin with chapter 1, and all you see there is that the believers began to pray, because they knew the secret of the fulfillment, the accomplishment of what the Lord had told them is in prayer. Just see it from chapter 1. Chapter 1 verse 14. "These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, with his brethren." You'll see that the Acts of the Apostles begin with prayer. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, verse 42, "And they all continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers." In chapter 3, verse 1, "Now Peter and John went all together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour." It's prayer all through. As we come to chapter 4, we're looking at verse 31. In chapter 4, verse 31, "And when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. In chapter 6, verse 4. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Esteeming one of the believers and the officers and workers in the church was being stoned, and he would not forget to still call upon the Lord in chapter 7 verse 59. And this stone Stephen calling upon God, saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and he cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And he, when he had said this, he fell asleep. In chapter 8, the prayer had not stopped, although it now went beyond Jerusalem, because the believers were scattered out of Jerusalem, and the believers went everywhere, and they were scattered abroad, preaching the word. And then Peter and John, they were sent to Samaria, and we find them again doing what they have always done from chapter 1. In chapter 8, verse 15, who when they were come down, prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Ghost. And you'll find that as people are coming to the church, that air of prayer, that atmosphere of prayer, that practice of prayer just pervaded everywhere. And as Paul the Apostle became converted and he gave his life to the Lord, the testimony about him in chapter 9 verse 11, and the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayed. You come to chapter 10, and we're looking there in verse 2, talking about Cornelius, a devout man, and one that feareth God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. You'll find then that as you open the gates of the church, you hear the volume and the sound and the power of prayer in the church. And as you move on into the various compartments of the church after opening the door of the church, you still find it is prayer. And as you round up the history of the church in the Acts of the Apostles, again it is still prayer. Every moment of the way and every way that they went, the church was a praying church. And no wonder that early church, they had power. In fact, there is a close connection between the prayer and the power. There's a close connection between the power and the praying. You look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, reading verse 31 and then verse 33, it says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. In verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Would you see here then that when we talk about the church, the real church, the church of the firstborn, and the church whose foundation is Christ, whose head is Christ, we find that that church was a praying church. Are we surprised? Jesus Christ himself was a praying Savior, because he prayed every time. He prayed alone. He prayed in the midst of his disciples. He prayed teaching his disciples. He prayed on the streets. He prayed everywhere. He prayed for the people. He prayed for the will of God to be done. And so the church that came out of him, out of the power of his resurrection, also became a praying church and a powerful church. The church has at her disposal today the mighty name of Jesus. That's what the Lord gave us before he went away. He said, whatever we ask in that name, he will give unto us. The church then has resources. The church has the privilege, and the church has the wherewithal. We can have the power that they had in the days of old. Look at how powerful and mighty and exalted and honored and glorified the name of Jesus Christ is. In Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 9, Philippians chapter 2 verse 9, wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. The name of Jesus that were given in prayer. The name of Jesus that gives us the power of attorney. That is, we can use that name. and whatever we demand will be given. We're told that name is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth. Think about it. In all the realms you can think about, the visible and the invisible, here on earth, or there in heaven, or even under the earth, among holy angels, and among human beings, and among a darkened spirit under the earth, it says the name has power, has authority, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. That's the name, my brother, you have. That's the name, my sister, that has been given to you. And with that name, you cannot fail. And you will not fail. You can use that name in prayer, and the Lord will answer your prayer. And corporately, unity in unity together, we can use that name, and we will succeed. With her, that is for the church, our unfailing promises of God, which are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Also, we have the presence of the Holy Ghost, who administers all the resources of the Godhead through the church to fulfill God's eternal purpose. The church is God's agency on earth that demonstrates His love, demonstrates His wisdom, demonstrates His power. The church then has the privilege of employing prayer to make effective the word, the name, the spirit in fulfilling the commission and the goal that God has given to us. And when we pray, God answers. Whenever we pray, according to the word, according to His will, according to His plan and purpose, God listens to the church when we stand in unity together praying. And God walks within the church. God walks through the church. He dwells in the church in fulfillment of what the Lord had said, that whatsoever you will ask in my name, I will give it unto you. Already we know the church that is built on the rock, built upon the rock of ages, that church will not fall. That church will not fail. Even though the gates of hell may come against that church, the hell, the hellish powers will not prevail. Because He says, He has given us the keys of the kingdom. And now it's in our hand, the authority and the power and the privilege and the possibilities, that whatsoever we bind here on earth, that thing will be bound in heaven. And whatsoever we lose here on earth, that thing will be loosed in heaven. When therefore saints unite in prayer, the power is awesome and the effect is unimaginable. Conversely, the church stands powerless. The church stands bewildered, ineffective, and threatened by religious and political walls around her, if we do not make use of the instrumentality of prayer. But with prayer, the church becomes a formidable force that the adversary cannot overcome, cannot conquer, cannot subdue. As we look at the story today, the power of a praying church, I divide into three parts. Number one, the picture of a praying church. What does that church look like? When you step inside that church, what do you see? When you hear that church with the volume of prayer going up to God, what do you hear? And what is the kind of church you see? That's a praying church. The picture, a militant church. A church of warfare. A militant and a successful church. And a triumphant church. A church that keeps standing. A church that knows. The picture of a praying church. Now, the promise for a praying church. The promises we have as individuals. The promises we have as families. The promises we have as a whole church together. The promises we have as we unite together, standing on the promises that cannot fail. The promise for a praying church. And then number three, the possibilities in a praying church. The possibilities in a praying church. I pray that as the Lord Jesus taught His own disciples to pray, and they prayed effectively, the Lord, as we study today, will teach us how to pray.
and we will pray effectively. And the world around us will not be able to conquer or subdue us in Jesus' name. I come to point number one, the picture of a praying church. As we come to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, I need to tell you the background to this. In chapter 3, Peter and John had gone to the temple at the hour of prayer. While they were just about to enter the temple, they saw a certain lame man who had been lame from his mother's womb. And he was at Beth Gate, that is called Beautiful. And then when Peter and John got there, he was looking at John, he was looking at Peter. And Peter fastened his eyes upon him. When John said, "Look on us." And this man said, "We are going to bring out money. But I'm telling you that prayer can provide something greater than money." It was at that time that Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none." He was going to use the kingdom that the Lord has given him. Because whatever you find on earth is found in heaven. Whatever you lose on earth is lost in heaven. The key is there, only that you have to use it. He used the key, silver and gold have I none. But what I have, such as I have, I give unto thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. That produced a miracle. It produced a supernatural. The religious people of the day were not happy. Because of that, they called Peter and the rest of the apostles to question. And then they even threatened them, "You dare not do that again." It was that made them now to come back to the assembly of the believers. And they reported to the believers what happened unto them. Instead of their grumbling, murmuring, complaining, fearing, getting worried, getting anxious, they kill Jesus, they're about to kill us, and they're going to stamp out everything, they're going to scatter us, we don't know what will happen again. They use the key in their hand, and that is our prayer. Let us see now the picture of this early church. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 23. And being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. And when they had heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord in unity and said, "Lord, thou art God, which hast made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is." And do you see how they started their prayer? They did start their prayer with all the troubles and with all the threatenings they had. They exalted God. They worshipped God. They lifted up the name of God. They glorified God. And they began to talk about the attributes of God. That will build confidence into them. That will build faith into them. They will know that this God had been before the earth, before the world, before the heavens were. And because of that, they will be very confident, because this God, the Ancient of Days, is greater than all their enemies. And then he had even prophesied and predicted in the word in verse 25, "Who by the mouth of thy servant David has said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things?" They say, we're not surprised. This is according to prophecy. And this is according to prediction. You have said it already in Psalm 2, that the heathens rage and the people imagine vain things. In verse 26, the kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed, against his Christ. Of a truth, against thy holy charge, Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, for the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together. You see that as they were quoting the scripture in their prayer, they were interpreting the scripture, they were applying the scripture. This again will build confidence into them. They said, we are not following fables, we are following the word. And we are following the word of assurance and certainty. Here is what you said about the Christ and about the anointed. Of the truth, against thy holy child, Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, and you have exalted him to be king and to be Christ. Pontius Pilate and Herod and the Gentiles and the Jews, the people of Israel, they have gathered themselves against him. For to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determine before to be done. Oh, they said, Lord, we're not thinking that these persecutors, they have any laws in their hand. We're not thinking that they can do anything that you have not ordained, that you have not planned. Do you see? Everything they were saying, everything they were praying about, it was based solidly on the word of God. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings and groans unto thy servants, that with all boldness they may speak thy word. He said, Lord, we're asking for something. We're not saying that you'll kill the persecutors. We're not saying that you will erase them, wipe them out. All we're asking for is, if they are bold for the devil, help us to be bold for God. If they are so sure of themselves and they are fighting for religion, which is vain and it has nothing, no substance in it, give us the boldness that we'll be able to stand for the truth and speak thy word. And then give us the supernatural power and confirm that word in verse 30 by stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child, Jesus. That was their prayer. And as they prayed, heaven responded immediately. As they prayed, heaven gave attention immediately. As they prayed, the answer came immediately in verse 31. And when they prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Their minds were all there. Their hearts were all there. Their concentration was there. And their faith was there. All of them without exception, as they united in prayer. And they all were saying the same thing, and praying the same thing, demanding the same thing, asking the same thing. The power came. The answer came. The response came for all of them. All were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that all of the things which they possessed was their own, was his own. But they had things all common, all things common, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon how many of them? Upon them all. That grace will be upon you. That power will be in your life. By the way, let us see where they were praying for. In Psalm 2. Psalm 2, I'm reading to you from verse 1. You will see then that the prayer of the early church was based on prayer, was built on prayer, was centered and focused, on the word of God. Their prayer was based and built and centered and focused on the word of God. What a challenge for you and for me, that before we pray, we go back to the word, and we allow the word to be the basis, to be the foundation upon which we build our prayer. In Psalm 2 verse 1, why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth said themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heaven shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath, and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. No wonder they were praying with confidence that no matter what the Pharisees did, no matter what the Sadducees planned, no matter what Herod had done, and no matter what Pilate had agreed upon, that God said, I have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord has said unto me, thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost part of the earth for thy possession. What confidence they had then that there will be converts. What confidence they had, what assurance they had, that as they prayed, that many people will turn unto the Lord. You'll find then that the early church was a praying church. In that text that I've read to you, you have seen a vivid picture of the typical prayer meeting of that early church. Their prayer was founded on the scripture. In that Psalm 2 that I've read to you, literally they prayed the word. And they asked for boldness to preach the word. in spite of opposition, and that signs and wonders be granted unto them to confirm their word. They prayed to God through Jesus Christ, and they prayed by the power and the influence and inspiration and illumination of the Holy Ghost. Their prayer enjoys sweet response from God, who answers prayer. Their prayer was, and our prayer ought to be, the climax of the response of that they had in that church to the oppression, to the injustice, to the persecution, to the suffering and the weakness, as we examine the prayer that they prayed in that early church. Some things come out to us very clearly. And as we look at these characteristics, this ought to be the bedrock of our prayer as a prevailing church. Let's look at them. Number one is saintly gathering. It was a gathering of the saints. A saintly gathering people that they came back into their company, and there was corporate praying. And then they prayed with like precious faith. Look at this, Acts chapter 4, again, verse 23. It says, and then let's go. They went to their own company and reported all that had happened unto them. And they reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said unto them. And when they had heard that, they lifted up their voice unto God with one accord. There was unity among them. The first thing they were to notice, and the first thing we're to take to heart, and the first thing we're to make sure we put in place when we come to pray, let's be of the same heart, let's be of the same mind, and let's come with people of like precious faith, like precious doctrine, like precious understanding, and then we're able to pray. Number two, another thing that we see in their midst. It's not only that there was a saintly gathering, there was singleness of heart. Singleness of heart. In fact, this is what we have observed even from chapter 1 as they prayed. In chapter 1, reading from verse 14, again, look at it. In verse 14, and these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. No pride, no rejection. And there wasn't any gossiping, and there wasn't any bitterness or hatred or suspicion or malice. They were all with one accord. In chapter 2, verse 1, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And as you come to chapter 4, that unity had not stopped. The unity continued with them. Chapter 4, verse 24. And when they had heard that, they lifted up their voice unto God with one accord. And they said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is. That's the second thing we're learning. When we come together, let's all have one heart. Let's love one another. Let there be affection. Let there be no division or line of demarcation between us. Let there be no grumbling, no complaining, no gossip, no tale-bearing. Let there be love. Number three, scriptural prayer. We've read that already. You'll see every verse, every statement, every moment of the prayer. It was scripture and scripture and scripture. Scriptures concerning who God is. Scriptures concerning who Christ is. Scriptures concerning the prophecy and the promises of the Lord. Actually, that's what the Lord has said, that when we pray, we must ask according to the word. We abide in the word. We allow the word to abide in us, and then it will give power to our praying. In John chapter 15 verse 7, John 15 verse 7, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Number four, we see that there were specific requests. They were very definite in their prayer. They were very specific in their praying. We see that from chapter 4 of Acts of the Apostles, reading from verse 29. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak the word. They were very definite as to what they wanted. They needed courage in the face of opposition. And before those persecutors, so they will not be timid. They will not be fearful. They will not be cringing. And they will not be compromising. And what will give them that courage is the boldness that comes from on high. That's why, specifically, what they were asking in prayer is that with all boldness, they may speak thy word. And can I tell you that the Lord answered and gave them exactly what they asked? Because in verse 31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. But they asked for another thing, very specifically, in verse 30, by stretching forth thy hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy child Jesus. Again, that prayer was answered, because in chapter 5, verse 12, and by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders done, and wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. In fact, was told in verse 15 in so much that he brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. And it came, there came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks, and them which were best with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one. They will see that another thing was that they had spiritual fervor. They had spiritual fervor. That is, the way they prayed, there was real fire within them, zeal within them, enthusiasm within them, passion within them. There was a stirring up within them, and that affected even the place of prayer, because we're told in verse 31, chapter 4, verse 31, when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. Spiritual power. They had that passion, that fire, that zeal, that enthusiasm, that interest, that desire. And it says, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. They were not sleeping, they were not dozing, and they were not slumbering. They really prayed with fervency and with fire. It says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Not only that, there was a sure response. As the Lord has promised that he will answer, he actually answered them. But not only for them, even for us. We're told in 1 John. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and verse 15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Oh, it's his will. They prayed according to his word in Psalm 2. They prayed according to the prophecy in Psalm 2. They prayed according to the prediction and the promise in Psalm 2. And because of that, their prayer was answered. If we do the same thing and search the word, and look into the word, and analyze the word, and apply the word, and quote the word, and stand on the promise of the word in our prayer, in the same way our prayer will be answered. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we have anything according to his will, his will is his word, his word is his will. If we have anything according to his will, according to his word, he heareth us. And if we know that he heareth us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions in the plural. We have the petitions, the many things we are asking. We have the petitions, our demands and requests. We have the petitions that we desired of him. And so we understand that as we too, as we come to the Lord and we pray, the assurance is that the Lord will answer. You look at John chapter 9. In John chapter 9, we're looking at verse 31. Because of the characteristics in their life, the conduct and the character and the behavior, that's the reason why it didn't take God too much to answer them. You look at chapter 9, verse 31 of John. It says, now we know that God careth not sinners. Those people were saved, and those people were sanctified, and they were living holy, righteous lives. It says, we know that God answereth not sinners. But if any man be a worshipper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. No wonder the Lord heard them. And as the Lord heard them, the Lord will hear us. I said the Lord will hear us. Here is the promise of the Lord for you, for me, and for the whole church. In Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21. I'm reading from verse 22. And all things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive. this year, you as an individual, all things whatsoever you will ask in prayer, believing, God will give you, you will receive. This year, your family, all things whatsoever you will ask in prayer, believing, you are going to receive. And as we come together as a praying church this year, we cannot fail. We will not be disappointed. All things whatsoever we shall ask in prayer, believing, the Lord will give unto us. Can I tell you to please write in your prayer request? When we meet together on Thursdays, when we meet together on Sundays, put in your prayer request. There is nothing too big, there is nothing too small, and there is nothing that is too chronic and too long standing that the Lord cannot do, because this year is a year of breakthrough. It's a year of blessing. And the abundance of the Lord will be in our lives in Jesus' name. When you pray and we join our prayers with your prayer, that circumstance will change. We will be strong in the Lord in Jesus' name. All through this week and all through this month and all through this year, go along with this promise of God. All things whatsoever you will ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. I come to point number two. In point number two, we have the promise for a praying church. The promise for a praying church. As the Lord is calling us this year to be a praying church, and is encouraging us to be a praying church, He has also given us the promise. And please, my brother, my sister, you know that the promise of God is sure, and the promise of God will be fulfilled. You remember, God is no respecter of persons. If He has said so, He will definitely do it. In Jeremiah chapter 29. Jeremiah chapter 29. Reading from verse 11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end. Would you please allow me to encourage you that this year, don't confess negative. Evil will not happen to you. Calamity will not come upon you. You will not be defeated, and you will not be overcome by the enemy in Jesus' name. Think the thoughts of God. Say the words of God. Confess what the Lord has said concerning you, because everything concerning you will be perfected. And God is going to perfect everything concerning you and your family. And this church, we're going to stand in the power of the Lord in Jesus' name. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart. That means your prayer will bear results, will bear fruit. And this year, there will be no failure in our praying in Jesus' name. In Jeremiah chapter 33, we're looking at the promise that's given to us as individuals, as families, and as the assembly of people of God together as a praying church. In Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Let your confession, let your utterance be like that. I'm going to call upon the Lord. The Lord is going to answer me. Don't ever say it again. God never answers my prayer. I pray, I fast, nothing ever comes out. Don't say anything that is contrary to what God has promised you. Walk along the promise. Confess the promise. And believe the promise. And it will be so. Call up unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. You know from the Bible already in Ezekiel chapter 36. You know that in chapter 36, He has promised quite a lot of things. He has promised us spiritual blessings. He has promised us supernatural breakthrough. He has promised us prosperity. He has promised us abundant provision. He has promised us satisfaction and sufficiency. And then He tells us something in verse 37. In verse 37, He says, thus says the Lord God, I will yet for this be inquired of by the house of Israel to do it for them. and I will increase them with men like a flock. It says, I promised many things in this chapter. And when you look at this chapter, it says many, many times, I will do this, I will do this, I will do that. And then almost at the end, it says, all these things that I say I will do, you still must ask me, you still must demand from me. And look at this in verse 11. In verse 11, and I will multiply you, man and beast, and they shall increase and bear fruit, and I will settle you after your old estate. If you had an estate, if you have an inheritance, if you had any property, if you had anything, any privilege, and somebody cheated you and removed you out of it, the Lord will restore it to you. He will settle you after all your old estate, your possession, and will do better unto you than at your beginnings. That's what you have to confess all through the year. Things are going to be better this year. Your spiritual life, things are going to be better. Matrimonial life, things are going to be better. On those your children you are thinking about, things are going to be better. In the fruit of your body, things are going to be better. All the plans, all the work of your hand, things are going to be better. And in your ministry in the church, things are going to be better. Because it says, I will do better unto you than at your beginnings, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. That's the promise of the Lord. Let's stand on that promise, and that promise will not fail. In Matthew chapter 18, Matthew chapter 18, reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 18, reading from verse 18. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And the question we need to ask ourselves is, why do you ever bind something? Why do you, for example, bind a dog and tie the dog down? Because the dog is very dangerous and is going about hurting people. And you have some little children at home, and you have some people that mistakenly might be beaten by that dog, and you say, you dog, you cannot continue like this. And you bind that dog. It's telling you any personality, any demonic spirit, any satanic agent that is running around, hurting you, hurting your family, hurting the church of God, with the word of authority in your mouth, when you bind, they cannot operate again. Powers of darkness in the community, powers of darkness anywhere around you, you will speak the word of authority, and whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever ye shall lose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. What do you lose to someone? And why do you lose them? You find that this individual, he has his great courage, he has his hands he can use, and he has skills and ability he can use, but somebody is tying him down somewhere and hindering him. And as they are tying him down, he is not able to use his skill, his ability. Therefore, you go there, you release him, you lose him. And all the people in your family, if anyone is bound in the bed of affliction, you speak the word, they are loosed and released in Jesus' name. Any of the beloved brothers and sisters in the church, their abilities they are not able to use, there's something always happening that is tying them down. And when you ask them and they say, well, brother, I'm in again. What do you mean? Well, they caught me again and see what I did, and I'm already now in captivity. I cannot come to the workers' meet anymore. I cannot do this anymore. I cannot be part of the people of God anymore. They're in a cage. Lose them by the word of authority, that nothing that is always coming into their life that will make them to be bound, and the skills and the abilities and the talents in them, they cannot use freely. You will lose them, and they are loosed in Jesus' name. Whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. And I encourage you, brother and sister, your coordinator, your wife is a coordinator. Instead of just complaining, and instead of saying, why are these busy people like this? Why is this happening? Why is this happening?
that time that we're using, that we're spending in complaining and criticizing and observing that things are negative, we can spend that same time and agree together that this negative condition will not continue in this district. This negative thing will not continue in this church. And husband and wife, we can agree. Brother and brother, you can agree. And my dear sister and our sister, you can agree. And we who are in the leadership in the church, we can agree together if we shall agree as touching anything that we shall ask of our Heavenly Father, it shall be done from heaven in Jesus' name. In chapter 16 of Matthew, reading from verse 16. And I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. For those who are listening to the Bible study somewhere, maybe you are in a village church, and the powers of darkness there, and the opposing powers there, they're saying, no, we don't want church here. Especially, we don't want a Pentecostal church, a praying church, a powerful church, a militant church here. We don't want a church like yours, Deeper Life. We want the other churches that are traditional, that if we want to sacrifice, they will sacrifice with us. If we tell them to contribute money, they will contribute money, but your own, that you will not worship idol, and you will not go along with the village ceremonies and idolatry. We don't want your kind of church here. Your church will not stay here. That church will stay there. Because the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In verse 19, and I give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Give me a good amen. And whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. It is done in Jesus' name. From verse 22, Mark 11, reading from verse 22, and there you will see the promise that we have been given. Mark 11, 22, Jesus answered, said unto them, have faith in God. My brothers and sisters, it's not just praying, it's praying in faith. Have faith in God. And you know there are people that pray, they pray much, but sometimes when you check up in the prayer, the prayer is not based, it's not built, it's not focus, is not centered on the word of God. Correct that. Let your prayer be based and built on the word of God. Number two, let your prayer be by faith, that you know that you are believing the word of God. He has promised and he cannot fail. Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he says. I will have whatsoever he says. I will have whatsoever he says. Caleb said, let's go up at once. We are well able. He had whatsoever he said. And then David said, this day I will give you the body of the Philistine, and I will give you the Goliath, I'll give you to the birds of the air. He had what he said, you will have what you say. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when you pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them, will have them. That's why when these believers pray, they actually believe the Lord. And as they believe the Lord, they receive what they prayed for. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness. The essence of prayer is the result. It's not just to pray, but it's to have resolve and answers when we pray. It is delightsome to note that God responded to prayer, the prayer of the early church, to confirm his presence in their midst and to fulfill his promise that he had given to them. Today, our prayer, our God has not changed. I said our God has not changed. And he has said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I will be in the midst of them. Though
The Lord is the builder of the church. He has given the church, the members of the church and the ministers of the church, the keys of the kingdom to bind and to loose with utmost assurance of answer to prayer. The church is enjoined in scripture to pray, and the redeemed of the Lord with holy hands and pure heart should in faith take their position in God's presence. That's what we will do. The promises of God cover various areas of church life, whether the problem be emotional, or physical, or spiritual, or matrimonial, or national. Prayer is the key. Prayer is the solution. Individual members in the church are called to pray. Elders in the church should pray, and the entire congregation should also pray unto the Lord. The promises of God is that He will answer our prayers, and they cover many areas. Number one, the conversion of sinners. Number two, our family needs. Number three, national requests. Number four, we are to pray for people in authority and all men. Number five, we are to pray for church leaders. Number six, we are to pray for the work of the Lord in the church. Number seven, we are also to pray against spiritual wickedness in high places. And the weapon of prayer we have will pull down all the evil powers in Jesus' name. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We have seen, number one, the picture of a praying church. Number two, we have seen the promise for a praying church. Number three, the possibilities in a praying church. The possibilities in a praying church. As we come back to the text in Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. And we read verses 31 and 33. Here we see one of the possibilities as we pray. In verse 31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost of God with boldness. In verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. The gathering of the church to pray must be with a purpose rather than mere routine activities involving her members. Prayer is a mighty weapon in the hand of the church with unprecedented outcomes upon the church, upon the world, as well as in God's kingdom. Earnest, sincere heart prayers based upon the word of promise, they will accomplish much in the church and in our lives. What will they accomplish? Number one, it will give us God's presence and God's power. Number two, such a prayer will embolden the saints of God to witness and to preach. Number three, it will make believers to be empowered to do exploits for the Lord. Number four, it will give us spiritual strength and maturity. Number five, it will give us persecution or accomplishment of world evangelization through mission outreaches. Number seven, it will also give us healing, signs and wonders, and also it will give us God's visitation, which will be released for imprisoned saints. It means quite a lot will be done as we believe the Lord and we actually pray. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 12. Acts of the Apostles chapter 12, and see what the power of prayer is, and what the possibilities of prayer, what they are. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 12, reading from verse 5, it says, Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. The church began to pray, because Herod was thinking, was going to bring up Peter the following day, and was going to kill, destroy Peter, and then scatter the church. And when Herod, in verse 6, when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door catch the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side, and roused him up, saying, Arise so quickly. And the chains fell off from his hands. It was their prayer, the prayer of the church, that brought the angel. It was the prayer of the church that made the chains to fall off. It was the prayer of the church that released Peter from that incarceration, from that imprisonment. And they were told in verse 8, and the angel said unto him, Gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, Cast thy garments about thee, and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true, but which was done by the angel. But such he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord. See what prayer can do. The people in the church were praying. And because they were praying, here is the effect and the result of that prayer. And they went out and passed on through one street. And forth the angel departed from him. When Peter was come to himself, he said, Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jews. In verse 12, and when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. And then in verse 24, but the word of the Lord grew and multiplied. That was the result, the effect of the people of God praying. Then we're told in Acts of the Apostles chapter 16, Acts chapter 16, reading from verse 13, Acts 16, verse 13, and on the Sabbath, he went out of the city by riverside, where prayer was wont to be made, and was sat down, and spake unto the women which resorted thither. You see here, the women were praying. And it was a prayer meeting outside the city because they could not find a location, a space, or a house within the city. Then we're told in verse 14, and a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple, of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, had us, whose heart the Lord opened, and she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized, and a household, she besought all, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful unto the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us, and the work of God continued, because the people were praying. Not only so, the work of God became established, because miracles, signs, and wonders were taking place. And in verse 16, and it came to pass, as we went to prayer, we were going to the place of prayer. They made it an appointment with the Lord every time that they were going to be praying. And he says, as we went to pray, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought our masters much gain by such saying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And they she did many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee, in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her. And he came out the same hour. Power resided in the apostle, because the people of God were praying. And we're going to continue like that. We're going to be praying like that. In fact, we're enjoined to pray. We're commanded to pray. We're encouraged to pray. In Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verse 18. Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verse 18. It says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, But you see the prayer here, we're to put on the armor of God. And while we put on the armor of God, then we're to continue in prayer. Let me read from verse 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. He may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. As we are praying, we must put on the whole armor of God. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. As we are wrestling in prayer, let us not wrestle against flesh and blood, opposing this brother, opposing that sister, opposing that man, opposing or criticizing that woman. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand as we stand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. As we pray, let's make sure that we're praying the prayer of faith, that we're taking the shield of faith, because it is that shield instrumentality of faith that will make our prayer effective, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Having put on all that armor of God, now we're ready to pray. In verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Our prayer then will be for all saints, for the strong ones and the weak ones, for the old ones and the new ones, for the new converts and the seasoned disciples. We are praying for all saints, for the brothers and the sisters, for the workers and the members. All prayer and supplication for all saints, and for me, Paul the apostle, the preacher, the leader, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. That's what you wanted the people to pray about, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought. That's the injunction of the people of God, and that's the commandment for the people of God, that we ought to pray, and we ought to abandon ourselves to praying, give ourselves to praying, because it's as we do that, we'll be able to actually resemble the early church. The effectual prayer of the church, number one, emboldens believers to witness to the resurrection, power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, that effectual prayer of the church will rout the adversary of the gospel world. And then number three, the prayer will enhance the spread of the gospel and the process of world evangelization. Number four, it will break strongholds. Number five, it will render impotent all man-made laws and edicts hindering the cause of Christ. Number six, the prayer will make the church to grow. Number seven, it will release the imprisoned saints. And then number eight, it will fulfill the objective of the church. And as the Lord has commanded us, we're going to pray. And as we pray, the Lord is going to answer. Already the word of God is telling us that we ought always to pray and not to faint. We ought to addict ourselves to praying, abandon ourselves to praying, and give ourselves completely to prayer. We're told in Luke chapter 18, verse 1. Luke chapter 18, verse 1. And he spake a parable unto them, to this end. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Always to pray and not to faint. Always to pray and not to faint. That's what the early church did. And the early church, they bombarded heaven. And they raised their voices and they prayed unto God in heaven. Come back to it in Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 24. And when they heard that, You have heard something already tonight. And you have heard the word of God. You have heard of the possibilities of prayer. And you have heard of the promises that are given to a praying church. And you have seen the picture of the praying church. When they had that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. And they said, Lord, thou art God, which hath made heaven and earth and the sea and all that therein is. And then they went on, and as they came to the end of the prayer, immediately God responded to them. God is going to respond to us. He is going to answer our prayer. And when they prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. As we pray tonight, our needs are met. Our hearts are strengthened. Our spirits are emboldened. And the boldness of the Lord and the courage of the Lord will go with us back home in Jesus' name. And this year, we will stand, will not fall. Everything the Lord wants to accomplish in our lives, in our ministry, in our church, He will accomplish in Jesus' name. They prayed, we're going to pray. They were answered, and we are going to be answered. The response came immediately, our response is going to come immediately. They prayed effectual fervent prayer, we are going to pray effectual fervent prayer. There will be no lack in our lives. Spiritually, materially, matrimonially, physically, there is no lack. Our prayer is going to be answered. It's now time to rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Say, God, I thank you. I know that your word is true. I know that your word is real. You have given us the promise. You have given us your word. We're going to allow our prayer to be based on your word, built on your word, focused on your word, centered on your word. And that prayer is going to be answered. That prayer is going to be answered. That prayer is going to be answered. Call upon the name of the Lord. Call upon the name of the Lord. We're asking for the conversion of sinners. We're asking for the restoration of backsliders. We're asking for the stability of the Christians. We're asking for the healing of the sick. We're asking for the deliverance of the oppressed. We're asking for the liberty of the captive. We're asking for prosperity for believers. We're asking for children for the barren. We're asking for spiritual strength for those who are weak. We're asking for boldness for our preachers, all our coordinators, all our pastors, all our overseers, all our leaders. We're asking for answers to prayer. We're asking for the power to bind and to lose. We're asking for this church to be militant, for this church to be triumphant, for this church to be powerful, for this church to be mighty. We're asking that this church will be the picture of the early church. We're asking that our women will be strong. We're asking that our youth will be saved. We're asking that the backsliders will be restored. We're asking that the stability, steadfastness in the believer's life. We're asking that our church will not be weak, our church will be strong. We're asking that this year will be a year of breakthrough. We're asking that this year will be a year of spiritual stability, steadfastness, and solid Christian living. We're asking that the glory of the Lord will be in this church once again. We're asking that the work of our hand and the labor of our hand will be blessed by the Lord. We're asking that all those who have been away, all those who are hiding their talent, all those who are hiding their skills, they'll be released. They'll come back and they will use their talent and skill for the glory of God. We're asking that the work of God will prosper in our hand. That the work of God will prosper in your hand. That the work of God will prosper in your hand. We're asking that God will say yes to all the promises you are putting before Him. We're asking that this year will be a good year for you, a better year for you. That what God has said, I'll do better for you than at your beginnings. That this will be the beginning of the fulfillment in your life, in my life, in every member and minister in this church. That this church will be what the church ought to be. Will go back to the revival, the renewal, the refreshing, and the power of the early church. The Lord is on your side. The Lord is answering your prayer. This year is going to be different for you.